Good afternoon, everybody. At the outset, I thank Dr. Vitul Gupta for inviting me again after 4 years to speak on a topic which is very simple but very important. And my talk is basically aimed to teach MBBS students. All the contents which I will be discussing are from a recent textbook of medicine, which is a Bible of medicine. Only thing which I have done is that I have simplified the things and put in a prospective manner. Outline is that we will be discussing various definition, terminology, types, epidemiology, risk factor, etiology, pathogenesis, signs and symptoms, diagnosis, differential diagnosis, management, complication and prevention in a span of about 20 minutes. What is the definition of urinary tract infection? It is the symptomatic presence of microorganisms within the urinary tract. Symptomatic. Urinary tract means kidney, ureter, urinary bladder and urethra. And these microorganisms, they are associated with the inflammation of the urinary tract. There are various terms which you have to understand the management of UTI. Uncomplicated UTI, UTI without underlying renal or neurological disease. Complicated UTI, UTI with underlying structural, medical or neurological disease. Recurrent, 3 or more symptomatic UTIs within 12 months. Reinfection, recurrent UTI caused by a different pathogen at any time. Relapse, recurrent UTI caused by the same species causing original UTI within 2 weeks after the therapy. Then there are other terms also like lower UTI and upper UTI. Lower UTI means infection involving the urethra, prostate and urinary bladder. And upper UTI means infection involving the ureter and kidneys. Urethritis is infection of the anterior urethral tract causing dysuria frequency and urgency. Cystitis is infection of urinary bladder causing all three with pyoluria and bacteriuria. And pyelonephritis, when this infection ascends to kidney, infection of one or both kidneys with pyoluria along with fever, chills, flank pains and ultimately kidney damage, renal abscess and even death. So with the knowledge of these terms we will go further. First is epidemiology. Now UTI is the second most important cause of infection to the human mankind after respiratory infections. It is seen in all age groups. Even in the infants up to 6 months, there is incidence of 2 per 1000 live births, and in infants, it's more in male infants. From age 1 year to 59 years, women are at greater risk, and prevalence is 40 to 50% in females and only 0.04% in males. About 45 to 60% women, they get UTI once in their lifetime, and out of that, about 20% women get recurrent UTI in their lifetime. About 15 million new cases of lower UTI are seen per year throughout the world. In old age, the incidence increases in males also, about 10% in males and 20% in females, because in old age, prostate becomes active. Now, what are the risk factors for UTI? Risk factors are related to specifically to females, to males, or certain risk factors are common to both. For females, the most important risk factor, why it is more in females, is shorter urethra. Then there is a risk factor like frequent sexual intercourse, use of spermicides and diaphragms during intercourse, maternal history of UTI. If the mother is having UTI, there are 15% more chances that daughter can also have UTI. Pregnancy. Then there is defective bladder emptying in the menopause. These are the specific to females. In males, prostate hypertrophy, bacterial prostatitis, urethral stricture, which is more common especially after diphtheria, gonococcal infection, lack of circumcision. Now certain factors are common to both, like poor personal hygiene, diseases like diabetes and use of drugs like SGLT2 inhibitors, impaired immune system like HIV, like malignant diseases, like post-transplant, and urinary obstruction or retention. So these are the various risk factors which can cause UTI. What are the signs and symptoms? First, lower UTI. Dysuria, that means the painful micturition. Urgency, a desire to go urgently to pass urine, although the urine output is very less. Increased frequency, urinary hesitancy due to pain, post-voiding dribbling, foul smelling urine, suprapubic pain or tenderness, sometimes hematuria. Usually fever is less or very mild in lower urinary tract infection. In upper UTI, which we also label as pyelonephritis, all these symptoms can be there which are there in lower UTI, but along with that, fever is a prominent feature. High grade fever with chills, nausea, vomiting, flank pain, tenderness into the costovertebral angle over the back, and sometimes even frank hematuria can be there. Extending to the perirenal abscess, there can be high grade fever not responding to usual antibiotics, and there can be severe prostration, pain in the back and lumbar area, severe vomiting and shivering. So these are the signs and symptoms of lower as well as upper UTI. Etiology of UTI, again this we divide into uncomplicated UTI and complicated UTI. In acute uncomplicated UTI, the most common organism causing UTI is E. coli. Almost 80% cases are caused by E. coli. Other 20% are caused by Klebsiella, Proteus, Streptococcus faecalis, Staphylococcus saprophyticus. The last one is more common with sexual intercourse. In complicated UTI, again E. coli is the most common, about 60%. Then Pseudomonas, Enterobacter, Serratia, rarely even Mycobacterium, Staph aureus, Salmonella, they all can cause complicated UTI. Certain viruses like Rubella, Mumps and HIV, fungi like Candida and Histoplasma capsulatum, and certain protozoa like Trachomonas vaginalis and S. hematomy can also cause complicated UTI. Pathogenesis. Now we will discuss pathogenesis under 2-3 headings. First, what are the roots of bacterial entry to urinary tract? There are 4 roots of bacterial entry to urinary tract. The most common is ascending infection, which is seen in about 80% cases. Hematogenous spread, less than 2%, and most common organism here is Staph aureus or Salmonella. Lymphatogenous spread, which can come from periuterine lymphatics, rectal and colonic lymphatics, and from prostate to bladder. Then rarely there can be direct extension from other organs like pelvic infection and genitourinary fistulas. There are 3 important factors which lead on to pathogenesis. They are environmental factor, host factor, and organism or microbial factors. This is a triangle which ultimately leads to either infection and colonization or elimination of the bacteria. And we will discuss all the 3 one by one. First is environmental factors. There can be change in vaginal ecology. E. coli colonization occur following sexual act. There can be use of non-auxinol 9 in spermicides, which can also increase the colonization. Later on, in later age, there may be lack of vaginal lactobacilli in postmenopausal period and the organism pre-weight. Then secondly, there can be anatomical or functional defects like stone formation, catheter, senile enlarged prostate, neurogenic bladder, small urethra in females. They are anatomical or functional defects. There can be medical devices like stents or nephrostomy tubes, and then use of drugs like SGLT2 inhibitors. So all these are environmental factors which lead on to pathogenesis of the UTI. Host factors, genetic background. As I have told you, females have got more UTI, and if the mother had suffered UTI, there are 15% more chances that the daughter can also have UTI. Then behavior factors. And here comes the role of permissiveness in sexual act. And if you are exposed to that, you will be having more chances of getting UTI. There can be underlying disease like diabetes, like HIV, like some other sort of cancer or even post transplant renal transplant cases where this can be a one of the host factor. And certain patients are having certain tissue specific receptors over their epithelial cells which attract UTI, and I am not going into detail of that, and they can be like toll like receptors or interleukin 8 receptors. Third part is microbial factors or organisms. Here the type of organisms matters. Why E. coli is more common? Because it has got certain characteristics which make it more adherent to the epithelial cells of urinary tract. Presence of virulence factors like K antigen help E. coli to become resistant to phagocytosis, and even the hemolysin cause damage to cell wall. And then there may be a fimbria in the E. coli. This diagram shows all this. There can be outer membrane proteins which are protective against complement mediated lysis. There is a release of cytotoxins like hemolysin, cytotoxin necrotizing factors which destroy the epithelial cells. And there are certain receptors, fimbria, which are more common with E. coli, which tie to the epithelial cells and lyse them. So that's why the E. coli is the most common organism causing UTI. How to diagnose UTI? Diagnosis is basically based on clinical history, although we have to take the help of test also, but in 80% times you can accurately predict that patient is having UTI from history only. Then there is urine dipstick test, which can tell us presence of nitrite, presence of blood, leukocyte esterase enzyme, which is seen if there is a pus in the urine. This urine dipstick test can be you can say specific up to 86% time, but usually it is routinely not done. Urine analysis, microscopic examination of the urine will show pus cells, RBCs, cast or bacteria. And generally some rule of thumb is that more than 5 pus cells in one field is sufficient to diagnose UTI from this only without culture. But urine culture and sensitivity is a most specific test. The colony count of more than 10 power 2 in females and colony count more than 10 power 2 3 in male is sufficient to have a positive culture. Blood investigations are also done to know the associated diseases, CBC, renal function test, electrolytes, blood sugar level, all these are routinely done. Then role of imaging test. Ultrasound is important. It can tell us about the features of cystitis, where the margins of the bladder become irregular, crenated, and there can be certain echo changes in the bladder. Or it can tell us presence of stones or other obstruction or any congenital defects into the urinary tract. There can be need for CT scan also in certain things, and cystoscopy or micturating cystogram can be sometimes used. Every patient of dysuria may not be having UTI, and there are certain differential diagnoses also, like cervicitis, gonococcal urethritis. In cervicitis, the discharge is thin, but in gonococcal urethritis, there is a thick discharge. There can be herpetic urethritis, interstitial cystitis, non-infective causes, and a peculiar term called acute urethral syndrome in females, which can just mimic like UTI. Management of UTI. The principle of management is, first is hydration. Second is relief of any urinary obstruction if any. Removal of foreign body or catheter if feasible. Treatable cause of genitourinary abnormality and metabolic defects like diabetes. Judicious use of antibiotics. Now this slide shows that role of antibiotics comes at the last. Although we start immediately the antibiotics, but we have to look for the other reasons while managing the patient of UTI. The choice of antimicrobial agent, the dose and duration of therapy depends on site of infection, presence or absence of complicating conditions. And I will be discussing certain treatment subsets. For example, first we will discuss uncomplicated cystitis in females, what drugs are to be used. UTI in pregnant, what drug has to be used, UTI in men, then complicated UTI, asymptomatic bacteriuria, catheter associated UTI and candid urea. So one or two lines about each. First, uncomplicated cystitis in females. The first line antibiotics are trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination, nitrofurantoin, phosphomycin, and a drug which is not used here, which is most likely used in most commonly used in Europe is fumicillinam 400 mg BD. Now the duration of treatment varies. As we see in the next diagram, nitrofurantoin can be used up to 5 to 7 days. Ceftran can be used up to 3 days. Phosphomycin 3 gram single dose can be used. 400 mg BD pivimicillam can be used. The last two drugs, that is beta lactams, cefodexin, cefexim, they are second line drugs. Usually in uncomplicated cystitis in females, we do not prefer quinolones or ciprofloxacin or levofloxacin. But sometimes you have to use urinary analgesics. A very commonly used name is peridium, fenzopiridine, which can give immediately relief to burning feeling. Other drugs can be methinamine, methylene blue, hyoscyamine, sodium phosphate. But most common is the first one. Now treatment of acute pyelonephritis, that is inflammation of parenchyma and lining of renal pelvis. Here the fluoroquinolones are preferred drug. Ciprofloxacin can be used from 7 to 14 days. Other drugs effective are trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination for 14 days. If the patient is admitted, then IV drug like ceftriaxone 1 gram IV per day for 14 days. Even gentamicin can be given 5 mg per kg body weight, or other drugs which are reserved, usually ampicillin plus sulbactam, piperacillin plus tazobactam can also be used depending upon the culture port. Chronic pyelonephritis, it has got certain types, xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis. It is an unusual form of chronic pyelonephritis characterized by granulomatous abscess formation, severe kidney destruction and clinical picture which may resemble renal cell carcinoma or even other inflammatory diseases, and usually nephrectomy of the affected site is done. Second is emphysematous pyelonephritis. It is seen exclusively in diabetes, production of gas in the renal and perinephric tissues, and there is bilateral papillary necrosis with rise in serum creatinine. Treatment is here by percutaneous drainage. And the third form is papillary necrosis with obstruction. Usually this is removed by intervention. Now if you see this CT diagram, there is a production of gas on one side of the kidney which has almost covered the half of the kidney, and this gas has gone to the retroperitoneal space also, arrowhead you can see. So this is a emphysematous pyelonephritis. This is an example of granulomatous pyelonephritis. In one diagram, there is one staghorn type stone shown on the left side, which has almost destroyed the lower part of the kidney, and on the other side, the stone has been removed, and still the kidney is affected and destroyed. So this is a chronic pyelonephritis where surgery is needed sometime for management. Now UTI in pregnancy, certain drugs are contraindicated and certain drugs are safe in pregnancy. The safe drugs are nitrofurantoin, ampicillin or amoxicillin and cephalosporins. But here trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole is contraindicated because it can lead to neural tube defects, and quinolones like ciprofloxacin is also contraindicated because it can lead on to damage to cartilage. Now in pregnancy there can be simple cystitis or it can be pyelonephritis. If it is simple cystitis, amoxi plus clavulanic acid orally 500 mg BD or nitrofurantoin 100 mg BD is sufficient to give for 7 to 14 days. But But if there is a pyelonephritis in pregnancy, this is an emergency. And then parenteral beta lactams combined with or without aminoglycosides are used. There can be use of cefotaxime, ceftazidime, cefepime, or even according to the culture, we have to use the imipenems. So this is a serious infection in pregnancy. UTI in males, it is along with acute prostatitis, then ciprofloxacin and trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole is effective. In chronic prostatitis, the treatment length can be increased up to 4 weeks. Consider associated prostatitis, chlamydial infection and epididymitis in different diagnoses of men with dysuria, and sometimes you have to add doxycycline BD for 14 days. The urine culture should be done in all cases of dysuria in men. The nitrofurantoin and cephalosporins are not preferred because they penetrate very poorly in the prostate. What is complicated UTI? Complicated UTI is that you can remember it with a formula of 5 P's: pregnancy, prostate or males, plastic or catheter associated UTI, poor control of drugs like conditions like diabetes or HIV or renal failure, and certain procedures have been done like stents intervention. If UTI is there in these conditions, in pregnant females, in males, catheter associated, along with diabetes, along with stents, this is a complicated UTI and it should be seriously taken, and drug treatment should be based on the culture report. What is asymptomatic bacteriuria? Sometimes there is a presence of bacteria in the urine but there is no symptom, and that's called asymptomatic bacteriuria. Normally there is no treatment given, but there are two conditions in which it has to be treated. Treatment is always given in pregnancy and in infants or children. And if culture is positive, then of course treatment is required. Catheter associated UTI, normally drugs are avoided, but if culture is positive, then 14 days course is required. There is no role of any prophylactic antibiotics if a person is catheterized. Candid urea, fluconazole 200 to 400 mg per day for 7 to 14 days, or even other drugs like flucytosine or parenteral amphotericin B can be added. So discussing the treatment, now what can be the complications of UTI? Of course, recurrence is the most common complication, but there can be urethral stricture, there can be pyelonephritis, there can be sepsis, there can be perinephric abscess, and even these two last, sepsis and perinephric abscess, can lead on to death also. If the pregnant lady gets infection, there can be prematurity or low birth weight. How to prevent the recurrence, which is the most common complication? There are general measures: increased fluid intake, good hygiene practices, urinating before and after coitus, cranberry juice intake. These are the general measures. They help sometime. But chemoprophylaxis is sometimes used. It can be continuous or it can be postcoital. The continuous prophylaxis can be up to 6 months or even sometime up to 1 year. Only trimethoprim 100 mg orally can be given for 3 to 6 months, or nitrofurantoin 50 to 100 mg for 3 to 6 months, and a new drug fosfomycin 3 grams sachet every 10th day. This is a drug which is now available in India also. Roughly it costs around about 451 sachet. So in conclusion, UTI are the most common bacterial infections after respiratory infection, second most common. Women are the most affected subjects in the population. E. coli is the most common cause of UTI for both uncomplicated and complicated UTI. Development of resistance to antibiotics results in problem in treatment and lead to relapse or recurrences. We are seeing up to 20% resistance to treatment of E. coli. Neglected or partially treated UTI can lead to damage to kidney, sepsis and even death. Do not give prophylaxis for adults with catheter and do not treat asymptomatic bacteriuria. The recent advances such as development of intranasal vaccines may result in lifetime cure of the infection. Thank you. Any questions?